1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 56 and 57 say what?
The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory. Thanks be to God. And we want to give thanks with a grateful heart to God. So this next selection will be sung to us. The words will be on the screen for you to follow, but this will be sung to you to follow along. Instruction, God gets us out into the world, or the real world. and say, and those things are brought to our, right to our forefront, right to our porch there. And the question is, Lord, what do I have to lean back on? Lord, have I studied your word? Have I been praying when I just sung this song about giving thanks? Am I going to really give thanks when push comes to shove out there? Am I going to say, oh, forget about this and be ungrateful, right? But God gives us the opportunity to exercise, and thanks be to God for that, what we supposedly have learned as disciples, right? That's what Christ did. When Jesus was with his disciples, let me show you where we're going this morning, to the book of Acts. But remember in the scripture when Jesus would go and go to a place, he would send a couple and say, hey, y'all go secure this for me. You go tell them. Jesus could have done all that himself. But what was he doing? Giving them an opportunity to act and to serve. Amen? Jesus said, go and ask the man and grab this donkey. And they went and did it. Go and secure a room for us to have stuff. Okay, and they did it. Jesus would send them forth. But Jesus was there and met the woman at the well. They went on ahead to do what? Purchase some bread and get some stuff. They could do some things. God gives you and I the opportunity to serve as well, just like that. Right? It's not just for mama to do and dad to do and pastor to do or your cousin or your big uncle or your nephew. You can get out and serve in the way that God gives you to serve and do that. Amen? And we want to do it and give thanks unto God with a grateful heart. So Acts chapter 17, we'll be looking at some of the, exploits and or adventures of the Apostle Paul here in this passage. In Acts 17, 15 through 31. Acts chapter 17, verses 15 through 31. Acts 17 and 15 begins by saying, and they that conducted or led Paul around, so there were some believers there who were taking Paul from one point or one place to another. Silas and there's one other gentleman had been left behind there to teach. But they took Paul with them and were leading him to Athens. And it says, and they conducted Paul, brought him unto Athens, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timotheus, for to come with him with all speed, they departed. Now, while Paul waited for them in Athens, so he's waiting for Silas and Timothy, to come see him, says his spirit was stirred in. So while Paul is simply waiting to get started, something began to move on the inside. When he saw the city, notice, wholly given to idolatry. It means everybody was doing kind of what they wanted to do as far as concerning serving God and other gods, little G-O-D-S's. Therefore, disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him. And some said, what will this babbler say? Like, oh, what do you got to say now? Other some, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection. And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is. You know, what's this new thing you got, Paul? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know therefore what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear something new. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars's hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. Y'all got too much going on. Y'all doing the most. For as I passed by and beheld your devotion, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship. Him I declare. And so Paul says, as y'all doing all this other kind of stuff, let me just pick up on that unknown guy over there and let me help make him known unto you. God that made the world and all things therein, verse 24, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything. He giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face or on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Verse 29, for as much then as we are, the children and offspring of God. For as much then as we also are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto any gold or silver or stone, graven art by man's device, or in man's device. And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commanded all men everywhere to repent. Because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men in all he hath raised him from the dead. Verse number 23 says, for as I passed by, Paul said, I was walking through your fair city here. I looked around and saw all these devotions and things y'all were doing. And he says, and I found an altar with the inscription, to the unknown God. So this morning, for just a few moments, we want to speak from the topic, the unknown God. The unknown God. Amen. Thank you, sir. Now, we've already read in our Old Testament scripture passage on this morning, in the book of Psalms, Psalm number 50, you recall, where we read about our Father, God in heaven, and how he wasn't going to reprove or scold his children Israel in their sacrifices. But God said, I don't need anything from you. He says, your little bullocks and your rams, say, all that's mine anyway. God says, if I were hungry, I wouldn't come to you begging bread. God said, because it's mine anyway. But the problem is oftentimes in the church today, we don't really know who, even though they had an altar to a quote-unquote unknown God, we don't really know who God is. We don't really understand the concept of the God whom we say we serve every day. Now, this morning, you also remember, we're praying for the people of India on this morning, right? These people over here in Asia, this country, India, we're praying for these people on this morning because it is very common in this culture for these people to worship and praise some anything, something made by men. Little gold images, little statues, little this, little that, right? It's very common for that sort of thing to happen over here. So much so that on our prayer list this morning, you recall, and I'm going to quote what this gentleman said. This man here from India says, his quote, now this is what he said, he wrote this. He said, I worship the suns, plural, the moons, the stars, and he said, and all kinds of, this is what he said he worshiped. Notice, the key thing right here in the beginning, he says, what I worship. Anybody ever been to school besides me? Anybody ever been to school? Elementary, anything about college, been to elementary, maybe a little junior high. When you see that ED on the word worship, what does that mean, somebody? Come on, brother, that's past tense. I used to. That's what he's saying. So you could hear say, I used to. But he says, I worshiped back when. It could have been yesterday. It don't matter. Amen. It could have been yesterday. It could have been 2 years ago. But I used to. But he said, that's what this man said. He said, I was born an animist, a religion local to my place, part of his culture, where he was there in India. He said, I did not know anything about the church of God, church, or the God they worship. Now here's the key thing. He said, but I hated them. I don't know what you're doing and why, but I just don't like you anyway. I don't care what y'all doing over there, and I don't want to know. I still don't like you much anyway. He said, not only did I not like you, but he said, in my country, Christians aren't treated well here. He said, and I thought it was for good reason. How many folks today who don't know who God is think they're doing God's work by hurting God's children, by hating God's children, by not wanting to participate, even get to know anything about God's children? You see, it's easy to stand from wherever you are. If you're over here in Georgia, or if you're in Alabama, or Mississippi, or Louisiana, it's easy to stand from wherever you are, your vantage point, and point at somebody else and say, you ignorant, you this, you that, and not know anything about that person. And just don't like you because you're different and you don't believe what I believe. That's the easy way to do things. That's the cop-out method. That requires little or no effort. It doesn't cost you a lot of effort to hate somebody. If I don't know about you, I don't care about you, I don't even know nothing about you, guess what? I just hate you for the sake of hating you. This man said, in the country where I come from, I used to do all this kind of stuff. I worshiped all this kind of stuff, I did this kind of stuff, but lo and behold, it goes on to say that one day, he bumped into a friend. And that friend was listening to a broadcast in his native tongue, in a language he understood, and the broadcast was talking about Jesus Christ. So much so, the man says, it broke me down. But notice he says, in a good way. See, he got broke down in a good way. He didn't know and didn't understand. He didn't really know. He told us here. He didn't know or didn't care about this God. Where did it say of her? He says, I didn't know anything about the church or the God they worship. God was unknown to him. He practiced all this other kind of old animistic stuff that we saw on this slide here. All this kind of stuff here and all these other kind of things and all the paints and festivals, all the little stuff they did. He knew about that. Worshiping suns, moons, and stars, right? He didn't know nothing about the church of God. And he said he hated them anyway. But lo and behold, he heard a message that broke him down in a good way. He says, and I met with Jesus and I never looked back. He got to know God this morning. But there are many people this morning who are still serving an unknown God. And unfortunately, a lot of them are doing it ignorantly. Back to the scripture now. Acts chapter number 17. Verse number 15. It says, and they that conducted Paul, or that led him, they brought him unto Athens, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timotheus for to come to him with all speed, they departed. Now, while Paul waited for them. So Paul is here for a purpose and a mission, right? But while he's waiting, it says something got stirred up in him. Church folks, I don't know about you, but today I'm waiting on Christ's return. I mean, Lord, say the same. I feel like I'm in pretty good health, so I don't see my death just going to come on me tomorrow. So, you know, short of some sudden illness, or God just saying, Robert, today is the day, right? Y'all know, and excuse the term, but y'all ever seen commercials? Because I don't play. Y'all ever seen commercials for the Georgia Lottery? And I come on the TV, and they talk about, today could be the day. And they sing that little song. Well, unless God just comes and says, Robert, today could be. Unless God comes that way, I'm looking for him to come get me in the rapture, right? Amen. Well, welcome, Mama. They invite you there too. But I'm waiting for it. But in the meantime, I don't just sit here, y'all, and wait and do nothing about it. See, you all and me all have a purpose and a mission that we ought to be feeling. Something ought to stir up. Come on, Paul. On the inside of us. And that while I'm waiting here for Christ Jesus, I get out and try to share with somebody else. See, it's not about me sitting here waiting for that gospel train, the bad train, and get your load. Guess what? While I'm standing there on that spiritual stoop, waiting for the train or the cloud or whatever it is, while I'm standing there waiting, am I going to tell somebody else about Jesus Christ? I know some folks that have had some in-depth conversation with people that you'll never probably see again in your life. Anybody ever been waiting in line at a grocery store and somebody take up a conversation with you? And before you leave, that little 5 or 6 minutes you waiting in Walmart, they done told you about their mom and you know more about this person. You don't even know their name, but they quick to share some mess about you or with you. You know, something you probably can't do nothing about. Right? But they just want to open up and what? Want somebody to talk to. Waiting on the bus stop. Have you ever had a story? Ever been on a plane flight going somewhere? And somebody just pick up and just start before you get off the plane. It's like, my goodness, you know what I mean? And nothing necessarily wrong, but you're like, wow, they really went there, didn't they? I know some of everything, how many kids they got, what their names is, but they just shared everything. Just in broken way on down with you. Because they're waiting, trying to kill time. But how many of us as Christians will take that same sort of effort while we are waiting, right? For Christ to return or to go meet him there. How many of us will take the same opportunity while we're waiting? To share with somebody. Does something get stirred up in you sometimes? Does something, like, as the songs they get to moving, come on somebody, on the inside? Does it ever show up on the outside so much so that I have to do something about it? You see, sometimes things show up, and we still sit there and say, I ain't gonna do nothing. Y'all remember what the little kids did a few years ago, the little vine thing? Do it for the vine. I ain't gonna do it. A lot of us in Christendom, God said, come on, Robert, do it for me. And I'm looking at it, so I ain't gonna do it. Come on, Robert, I get this opportunity. I ain't gonna do it. We look at this God that we're supposed to be giving thanks to with a grateful heart. And we tell him, Lord, I don't feel like it. I ain't going to do it. Thank you to God, Paul stepped up. It says that while the man was waiting, so he knew he had a mission. He knew something was coming. He had these guys coming to him. They were going to do what thus saith the Lord. But in the meantime, did he take a vacation? Did he take a break? No. It says, while Paul waited for them, his spirit was stirred in him. What stirred it up, Paul? What got you started, man? He says, when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Do we look out at the state of our world today and see people who are ignorantly worshiping an unknown God or unknown? Do we look out and see people who are just missing the mark and does something get stirred up inside of a soul that we say, man, I got to do something about this? And not that I'm trying to change the world per se, but I got to inject some Jesus Christ into this situation. If for nothing else, to invite them into a relationship with my Savior, my Lord and Master, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
They need to know. They need to hear. I ain't no preacher. I ain't at church. This ain't Sunday. Okay, whatever. Don't know what day it was. We know Paul wasn't inside no church, and he left. These other two were back in synagogue. They were taking him on his way to. And he looked around and saw what was going on and said, this place needs Jesus. Can you look at situations in your life where Christ needs, where need a good stiff injection of Jesus Christ? Right now, at least for the past couple of months, they've been encouraging all of us to get flu shots. Get your flu shot. Get your flu shot. I went to pick up a prescription at Kroger the other day. And they have a sign up on the prescription counter that says, if I don't ask you about a flu shot, you get 100 points. 100 points at Kroger means you get 10 cents off the gas. So they try to put a little money into it. You know what I'm saying? If I don't do my job, and that's what they're saying, you're going to get 100 points you can do something with. But they're trying to encourage us to get an injection. Get an injection. You know what? We need to be encouraging folks to get a nice injection of Jesus Christ. You know, these flu shots, a lot of folks get flu shots, and what do? Make folks sick, don't they? They put a little flu in you to get you better. Well, guess what? We need a whole lot of Jesus in us to get us what? Get us right. And guess what? Don't cost us nothing. Flu shots cost money. Because I started to ask someone in my little job, I would say, well, is the shot free? You know, you asked me to take flu. Is it free? I knew it wasn't. So I didn't ask that. I signed my little prescription, showed my Kroger Plus card, and I got out of there. But you know what I'm saying? They want to get you to do all this kind of stuff, and they're going to advertise it for you, but that costs you something. Salvation is free, right? It cost him, being Jesus Christ, everything, but it's free to you and I to accept. But the Bible does encourage us to do what? To count up the cost. It does cost to serve him. Cost me some time. Cost me some of my will. You know that permissive will that God gives and says, Robert, I'll let you go on and do what you want to. If you want to, guess what? You'll end up in hell. But Lord, you know I need to be in heaven. God said, yes, I do, my son. My desire is that all men would be saved, but unfortunately, some folks ain't going to get it right. Some folks going to stand there and be talking about, I ain't going to do it. And they're going to end up right in hell. And God going to be like, I sure didn't want to do it. But guess what? You got one or two places, heaven or hell. Paul says, the Bible says it stirred something up in him when he looked around at the state of affairs where he was. And it says, therefore, he did something about it. What did he do? He disputed in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met him. So he didn't just stay in the church with them. So we got to get outside them walls and try to bring this unknown, quote-unquote, God to make these people know who he is. Because that's what Paul is going to get to in just a moment. These people were worshiping an idol, an altar for this one, an altar for that, an altar for that. And he kept looking and saying, altar to an unknown God. He said, better preach. And he used something right there from where they were to try to bring them into knowledge of a saving Christ. So as Paul says, the scripture says, in the synagogue he disputed with them, with a devout person and in the market. So he made himself available. He was out amongst the people sharing the gospel. So for people who want to say, keep that in the church, that's what the world wants to say. We don't mind even being a Christian, but keep that in the church. Don't bring that into our school. Guess what? I'm a Christian. So wherever I am, I take Christ with me. If I'm on my job, I bring Jesus with me. If it offends you, too bad. When I sit down to eat my lunch, my wife packed for me, I'm going to ask God to bless him. Get mad if you want to. I take Christ with me. And I ain't doing this for no show for you anyway. You know what I'm saying? I'm honestly giving thanks, hello, somebody, with a grateful heart. Yeah, Lord, I had the same thing last night. It sure was good. Father, I'm going to eat again for lunch. Bless this food. Give me some strength. Let me finish out this day. I make it talk to him real quick in that little prayer about how my day is going.
Yes.
Lord, these first 4 hours have been hell on wheels up in this place. Lord, I need a break. But Father, right now, I get 30 minutes of peace. Let me eat this little old food. Let it taste good. And Father, give me strength to finish these last 4 or 5 hours so I can go home and be with my family. Right? Amen. It's not just about what's in front of me there. Lord, thank you for where I am so far this day. But just give a word. But Paul took it into the synagogue and in the marketplace. Says, but then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and the Stoics encountered him. See, the Grecian people were, they thought they were real educated and smart. Everybody liked to pontificate and philosophize. All this other kind of stuff. Big words and share stories and, you know, spin tales and all this other kind of stuff. People actually got lauded for that type of thing. That sort of ability to share a story, to bring the audience in. Because guess what, y'all? They didn't have no internet. Wasn't no YouTube. Couldn't just go pull it up and say, man, let me show what I'm talking about, right? Everybody going crazy. That little Shirley sees a video right now. The beans, greens, potatoes. Everybody going crazy. Snoop Dogg even did one. I pulled up one on Thanksgiving. He got one now. He got a plate of food sitting out in front of him. He on his couch. He up there. I got me some beans. He slow his little Snoop. He slow it down. But yeah, he got his thing going on. With the beans, greens, tomatoes, and all that other guy. That's the hot thing right now. Can't pull that up nowhere. So in order to bring you into the story I'm trying to tell you, I had to be able to bring you in with my words. I had to do that. So these people were known for doing it. So you got these Stoics and Epicurean people. And I remember learning about this in high school. Didn't know it was in the Bible then. But the Stoics and Epicureans encountered him and they said, what will this babbler say? Meaning that, look, we're the great, you know, we're the great storytellers and the great people. Isn't that what you got to say, man? Ain't nothing you got to say. They called him a babbler in the first, like, you ain't got nothing to say. Just babbling, babbling. What you got to say, Paul? So they're looking at him and questioning. Paul didn't pick a fight with him, but guess what? They started one, so Paul addresses the situation. And some other people said, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preaches unto them Jesus and the resurrection. What he was preaching, they called a strange god. Now they got altars and stuff built up to all these different quote-unquote deities, but Paul preaches Jesus and his resurrection, and that's quote-unquote a strange god. The world looks at us today and think we serve a what? Strange God. They don't know. They don't understand why we do what we do as Christians. And guess what? Is it wrong? Should we expect, I know my wife so beautifully shares it, should we necessarily expect folks who have no inkling or iota of information about Jesus Christ to understand? No, not necessarily. God has to bring them into a saving grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. When we can teach them about the Christ on the printed page, like I tell you, I heard these terms, Stoics and Epicurean, when I was in high school English. It didn't mean nothing to me then. I learned it machine, I memorized it for the test. Well, I could try to make A. I don't know what I made, but I tried to memorize it because they asked us the difference between the two for a test. And that's all I did. Once I used it for that test, I ain't never used that term before. But lo and behold, here it is in the Bible, Acts chapter 17. It probably would have done me a little better to pay a little more attention in school back then, but I was just trying to get that grade and move on. But here it is in Scripture. The Bible even speaks about the Stoic and Epicurean folks in Greece. And they took him, verse 19 says, and brought him, being Paul, unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is. So they were quote unquote curious. And now, he says, for thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things. They said, what you saying? That's kind of different. We never heard that before. Come on, our ears is itching. Tell us some more of the story, Paul. As though he just shared with them some kind of story that they're going to enjoy. Okay? He says, for all the Athenians and strangers which dwelt there, notice, they gave themselves to nothing else but either to tell or to hear something new or some new. They just all sat around and want to do something. I ain't trying to be funny. I ain't trying to point no finger. But that's an early edition of Facebook right there. When folks go on there, because I tell you, with my Facebook, I tell you, I have a page for me, and I have a page for our church. The only reason I have a page for me is because to make one for the church, back then they made you have a personal page. Okay, so I got one. I hardly ever, if anything, post anything on my page. Now all my little friends' feeds come up in there. I see somebody's birthday, say happy birthday, but I tell you, the biggest thing I do with Facebook, I log on and I can see what folks ate for thanks, because everybody put all their business right out there. And some folks, that's all. It's seriously, I'll be wondering how some of these folks work. But Brother Robert, don't you know you can do it on your phone? But yeah, but if I'm on my phone still telling somebody, I'm supposed to be working, I ain't working, am I? Huh? Well, you might be sitting at a computer. I know folks with warehouse jobs. Ain't no computer in the warehouse, and they be posting during the day. Man, check this joke out. He fell asleep in the break room. Or so-and-so was Facebook Live. I got a friend of mine, I ain't gonna call her name, because she might see this. But I got a friend of mine I know to work at Waffle House in Riverdale. And I have seen more live videos of the Waffle House in Riverdale while they working, but they at work and going around. I'm thinking, you know, now back when I used to work at McDonald's, I don't know about now, that we couldn't take pictures at work. You know, now that it's a great big secret, but there again, competitors may see somebody, may, you don't just go flash and all that. But this young lady, bless her heart, I mean, they be live on Facebook almost every week at her job. I'm thinking the mom's be right in it too. She be, hey, and they be smiling and looking. They did a mannequin challenge up there at the job. They did a thing. Everybody stopped. Somebody pouring eggs. He stopped. Somebody sweeping the floor, he's down. And all they just lie, just looking to see. Some folks, all they do is just get out there every day, see what's new, what somebody else doing, right? That's all these people were doing back then. And guess what? Now we can do it much easier. We ain't got to go in the group no more. You can sit at your house, in your pajamas, in your boxers, with no shoes on, and sit there and look at the screen and just check out what everybody doing. What's going on? Ooh, I see so-and-so ate this. I got somebody, a friend of mine in Dallas, took pictures, it's so embarrassing, of his relatives sleep on Thanksgiving. He said they got that, what's that thing called? The itis. Yeah, so they ate that good old food, brother. He said they were knocked out. I mean, grown men laid out on the couch. Both be watching the game. Game watching them. Some woman was laid on an ottoman. You know, an ottoman is small. You couldn't even put your whole body on it. She balled up, feet ain't. I mean, it just knocked her all the way out. I don't have no business knowing that. But somebody posted and said, so-and-so has sent a picture. So I looked to see what it is. Oh, my goodness. So I sent a little comment back. I sent a little thing for the boondock, for the little itis thing. But people put all this kind of stuff out there. That's nothing new. These people, all they live for, y'all, is what's going on? What's the new? You know, as a little song say, tell me something good. That's all they wanted to do.
Yeah.
Right? They wanted to hear and see what was going on. Just nosy people. And none of this stuff had nothing to do with nothing. So Paul says, all right, I got something for you. I'm going to tell it like the TIE. Says these people live for nothing, it says, but to give themselves to tell or hear some good news. So Paul stood up in the midst of it and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. Remember now, going back to how people have ended? Too superstitious. You worship to this thing, to that thing, you do this, you dress up for that. Man, y'all just got too much going on. As my sister-in-law would say, y'all doing the most. Mm-hmm. So Paul says, you all are too superstitious. He says, for as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I looked at all this stuff y'all had. He said, y'all even have the nerve to have an altar that y'all says written on it, unto the unknown God. You know, just in case we miss one, well, here's one over here, so this God will be appeased and won't be mad at us. I mean, because you got this, you know, whatever they had back in Greece was the Grecians, they're Zeus, right? So Zeus and then Africa, Venus, whatever they look, they got God, little temples and altars set up to all their little gods and goddesses, right? The Grecian stuff, and then, well, in case we miss one, here's this one to this unknown God. Paul says, I'm going to take what you did and work it out for you. So Paul says, you have an altar whereon is written, unto the unknown God. Notice, he says, whom ye then ignorantly worship. He says, him I show unto you. He says, you don't know, but God, Paul says, I'm going to introduce you to him. So Paul in essence saying, look, I'm going to give you a ticket to the temple of this unknown God. I'm going to invite you in now to know this unknown God. He begins by saying here in verse number 24, God that made the world. Now, you know who we're talking about then, right? God who made the world. Hello, Genesis. In the beginning was the word. In the beginning, when God said God created the heavens and the what?
Earth.
There you go, son. Somebody know the scripture. God that made the world and all things that are therein. He says, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, he dwelleth not in temples made with hands. You know, you can't make no place to contain him. That's back like in Psalm number 50. You can't make no dinner and serve him. God said, if I'm hungry, I'll get it myself. You ever go to the grocery store and I talk to my ladies? You may do that, brothers, but I don't do a whole lot of shopping, so I'm going to hit the ladies real quick. But ladies, you ever go to the store and pick up a roast or something and you get one and get it home and it don't necessarily be right? You know, you say, ooh, this don't taste like it. You buy something, you know, you buy a pack of crackers and get them home and they stay. You know, you buy something expecting it to be like the picture or to taste like it did last time. But you ever buy anything and you get home and it's just not quite, the standards and the quality is just not what you were used to? Now imagine you and I, quote unquote, finding something for God. God had stipulations. And go back in your Bible and look around what Deuteronomy and Exodus and Leviticus. When God gave the laws about how they should sacrifice animals, they were supposed to bring firstlings, right? Animals without a spot or a blemish. The best they had to offer, amen, somebody, is what they were to give God. But you know, even out of some of them best, some of them things could have been sickly. Or it could have been something going on that we don't know. So if God were going to feed himself, come on somebody, and he knows what's happening, don't you think he'd pick the best? Now if God wanted him a good old Angus steak, I've gone some places, not that I do a lot, but and had a steak and sometimes it'd be kind of dry. And I put all that 57 on it, still don't be right. I'm like, man, this, I ain't going to get another one of these. This place, I got you. They got me, and I got to pay for it. But God would know from the inside out, amen, to get what he wants. Who am I to bring him a plate of anything and think he's going to like it? Ever made a dish sometime and got too much salt in it? Ooh, I forgot my whatever. Ooh, I didn't put this in my bread. It didn't right. Little bitty thing. If God said it, I'm going to get it yourself. It belongs to me anyway. So Paul said, it's not for you to make a thing you can do. You can't house nothing. You can't build him anything. Because what you build it out of is his anyway, ain't it? Who made the trees? Who made the stuff you make, the mortar and pestle and all that? Who did all that kind of stuff? Come on now. Well, we got this clay and we formed. Yeah, you formed the clay. But what did you say you did with? Well, we got the clay. Okay, where the clay come from? Well, see, See, when it gets down to it, what's that song Helen Baylor said years ago? It all begins and ends with you. Come on now. Mm-hmm. So Paul says in scripture here, he says, neither is he worshipped with men's hands. So you can't, he don't dwell in temples. Verse 25, neither is he worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing what? He gave it to all life and breath and all things. You can't be God-given. You can't give him anything. It's all his anyway. But Paul says, I'm trying to invite y'all in now to know this quote-unquote unknown God. He says, and he hath made of one blood all mankind to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath assigned the seasons which were ordained before and the bounds of their habitation. And what we look at here, not only has he made us all one blood, even with all our differences, right? Short hair, long hair, this color, that color. We're still all one blood. God has done all of this. And when it talks about habitations and seasons, you can look at your natural seasons, your springs, your summers, your winters, your falls. But look right now in November. You know, we had, what, 70-some degrees last week, and then it was kind of freezing yesterday and today. Right here in November. It's supposed to be, what, fall going into winter? Hello, somebody. So not even just those type of seasons. Look at what God did as far as people. Go back and look at your Old Testament. When God would raise up somebody, hello, for a season, hello, and allow this person to rule for a season, allow them to rule his people and rebuke them for what? A season. God said, I do this unto the habitation. I'm the one who's in control of that. You may think you got it going on right now. God says, I have all of this ordained. Winter, amen. All them little seasons, and there are other seasons of life as well. So God says here, he says, the season which were ordained before and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord. Why? If so be they might have groped after him and found him. He says, but though doubtless he be not far from every one of them. People reach out. That's why we have folks who are doing this right here, worshiping God ignorantly, or an unknown God ignorantly. Because they're reaching out for something. There's something that people realize there has to be a greater something. And when folks can't put their hand on it, what do? We make up stuff. Ever have somebody ask you a question you don't know the answer to, and you kind of what? Make up something? You kind of just throw it out there a little bit, and Lord, don't let them run off with it. It's like, oh, wait. And you know you just told them a lie. But now, you know, it's cool as long as it's y'all two. But when they go and share it, man, it's like, oh, my goodness. And, you know, they're going to get out there, man, he told me that. I'm like, man, who told you that? Man, that is stupid. Man, you about make up stuff. That's why we make little idols. You know, when the children of Israel, when Moses went up on the mountain and was gone, and they got fearful. Well, let's make us a calf. Let's make us a golden calf. This be what brought up. Wait a minute. You mean some of the same thing that the Egyptians gave you? You know, y'all got some stuff. Remember all that stuff God had Pharaoh and his people give y'all when y'all left? All the animals and the cattle and the gold. All this stuff. So you remember trying to say that one of them little beasts of burden is what brought you out? You mean you prayed to that and that's what did it for you? So you're going to take all your gold now and form it into a gold? Hello, somebody. What? Does that make any kind of sense? But we have folks who do that same thing today. We'll take, and like the scripture goes on to say, we'll worship the creature more than the creator. God gave calves and cattle and sheep and all that, but you're going to take that and say, that's what brought you out, huh? So the scripture goes on to say that they should seek the Lord, because if they had groped and found and people are still looking, he says, even though he's not far from them. God has never been far away from us. He's always been right there within our grasp. And he's really only, if we say the psalmist is only a prayer away, but really to come to God, he's always there, because the fact of God being omnipresent means he's here and there and everywhere all the same time. Anyway, so it's not like he's far away. Remember what Elijah said when they were out on the mountain and they were trying to have this little contest? Elijah said, well, you call your God and let him do this. And Elijah said, well, maybe he's far away and he can't hear y'all. Yeah, louder. You know, these people got to getting themselves into a frenzy, cutting on themselves, all this other kind of stuff. And there they, Elijah kind of, y'all finished? Okay, Elijah, put some more white on. And he just simply called out. And God wasn't away. Lord, can you hear me? Yes, our Father is, the Bible tells. Yes, he's in heaven, wherever it is. But when I get on my knees and pray, you know, I'm praying right now as I preach. I'm talking to him. I ain't got to raise my voice up real loud. I can get pretty loud if I want to. That has nothing to do with God hearing me. God is not that far away from it. A man who looks and seeks after God can find it. But these people would rather have a what? An unknown God. Make something up with all these other laws and then do what? This unknown God thing here this morning. He says, why? For in him, verse number 28, we live and move and have our being. As also certain of your own poets have said, for we are his generation. And in looking at this, anybody, and I just asked you because I found out in doing my little study here, anybody happen to maybe think you know what poet he may be referring to? Paul is taking something they know. Remember, Stoics and Epicureans, right? So they pride themselves on knowledge and spinning tales and sharing wisdom, especially that they got from other people, right? People that would be characters of Grecian history and in antiquity. They would quote these people. Anybody have any idea what poet they may be talking about?
Homer?
Nah, not the same. Make sure I pronounce his name right. His name starts with an A. Where did I look at it? It's Artus and Cleanes. A-R-A-T-U-S. Aratus was a poet who lived, and these people go around quoting him. Now, the man wasn't very learned himself. He wasn't. But he wrote this poem, and one of them is called, like, it's pronounced almost like phenomena, and then there's an end to it, dis-something, D-I-S. But in this poem, he's quoted as saying that we're all offspring of God. In this poem, Paul says, I'm going right back to where you've been. You know what that shows us about Paul? It shows us two things. Number one, he knew his audience. Number two, Paul has some sense about it. You see, Lord, deliver me from a person who says, I don't even know nothing about you in order to reach you. Look at what Paul did. Paul began right there, come on now, where the rubber met the road for those Greek people. When he mentioned their fellow poet, now look at who he's talking to. Stoic and Epicurean people. When he said that, don't you know their minds went right to the poet he was talking about? Paul said, I'm going to use right what y'all already quoted and show you how my God is real. And I'm going to make this unknown God known unto you. Christian people today, it's time out for us thinking we're going to reach people just by hollering Jesus, singing songs, and giving them a little bit of New Testament, some tracts in the hand. Do we know anything about it? Do we have any sort of common playing field to where we can approach this person to have an intelligent conversation about God and about Christ? Realizing it's not my job, thanks be to God, to win anybody to Christ. My job is to expose them and invite them. Because remember, the scripture teaches, and I believe the Bible, God says he does the drawing.
Yes.
He does the revealing. There are folks who have come to know Jesus Christ who've never been in a church. They've never been street ministry or witness to. Nobody ever come knocking on their door talking about, hi, we're from the so-and-so, this church and that church. We want to tell you. They never had a knock on their door. Never seen a Christmas special or anything. Never done any of that. But still, somebody like that will get to know Christ because God does wrong. Because as the scriptures say, men just grow. People looking for something. Folks sometimes can pray to God unbeknownst to them. They're praying to a God they don't know yet. There has to be something, and they just call out, maybe something they've seen, or just in their spirit. They may not even get down, close their eyes, but they're missing something, something in their life. Their life is empty. They need something. God can reveal himself right to them. Okay? But we look here now in Scripture. Paul says, for in him we live, we have our being, as your poets have said. So he's talking about this poet, so he quotes them right directly. So church folk, be good for us to kind of know what? Our audience. Right? Know your, I think it's a book or whatever. Know your enemy. You got to kind of know something about them and how these people act and react. Now, if I was going to witness to a Muslim person, there are some areas I know that as soon as I go into, bam, they're going to cut me off. That opportunity for witness is gone. If God has sent me there, right? See, it's not about me going because I think, well, these folks, they heathens. They need Jesus. If God don't send me, I'm going to be barking at the wrong tree anyway. I need to be on the assignment of the task force. God has sent me to do, right? God didn't send me over there to witness to this man in India. God had through the Bible over there. God had a friend of this man's. Hello, somebody. Somebody he already had a relationship with. A bond of trust of some sort. And when this man was listening to it, this man coming to the house and said, wait a minute, that's my friend. What is that? And he heard this in his own language. He sat there and listened long enough to where God could touch his heart. And it's because of this earthly friend that he had. You think that friend may have ever talked to him about Christ? Maybe not. But it said, this man said he was a madman. He was a drunkard, alcoholic, walking through the street. But just lo and behold, this day he was sober enough or whatever to find his way to this friend's house and just so happened to broadcast something that would touch his heart. And now he says he's not going to turn back. So he says, for as much then as we are the generation, verse 29 of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone graven by art, and the invention of man is nothing we make up. It's not nothing that we got to be able to handle on, because a lot of times concepts that are too big for us, we just make up stuff. We just throw something out there. Well, I'm going to make this little statue. Okay, that's going to be my God. Somebody put my hands on. I don't need a God I can put my hands on. I want somebody to put their hands on me when I get out of line. Verse 30, in the time of this ignorance, God regarded not, but now he admonished all men everywhere to repent. There was a time before when God just kind of winked at this ignorance, this foolishness. Paul says the time is now when you need to get it right. You need to repent. So guess what? If this was, this is about AD 51, about 50 or 60 or so years after Christ's death, if back then God was tired and sick and tired of all this kind of foolishness, what do you think he is today? Hello, somebody. This is 2016. We're some thousands of years away from that. Do you think folks still need to be repenting even right now? Do you think it's still time out for all that foolishness right now today? Yes, it is. You think something ought to be stirring up inside of you and I as we look out at the state of our world today? That ought to send us out to share with people. Man, all this kind of stuff y'all doing, this foolishness y'all doing, let me come right here to you, right in the vein of what you're speaking, and share with you how that's foolishness and how God needs to get the glory anyway, even in that situation. Paul brought it right to them on terms. They could have said, he came to their field. You know how you have a game, you have a home team and a visiting team? Paul was a visitor. But he came on the home team's field, used some of their information. Yeah, your own poets have said this, that, and the other. Paul, like, you call me a babbler? Like, I'm just talking out my head and you can't understand me? Paul says, I got something for you. I can drop names and stuff and let y'all know I know something and still tell you how God is real. Still tell you how I know this God that y'all call is unknown, that I know that he's real. He's invisible. You can't see him and can't touch him, but he's real. He said, the time of this ignorance God ignored. Verse 31, why? Because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath appointed. And that man he appointed, of course, is Jesus Christ. But by that man whom he hath appointed, whereof he hath given an assurance to all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. And oh, Lord, lo and behold, okay, he shares with them. I can come right down to where you are. I can quote your poets and let you know how God is real. But when he throws out the term resurrection, look at what it says they did. Now, when they had heard of the resurrection from the dead, some mocked, and others said, "Woo, we will hear thee again of this thing." And it says here, and so Paul departed from among them. Wow, man. You know, Paul broke it down. He got right down out of where they were. He tried to make known to them this unknown God, share with them how foolish this was, letting them know, man, y'all need to repent. Y'all need to get it right. Don't put off tomorrow what you can do for the day. And it says that he left. You're like, man, no, man. Paul laid it on them jokers, man. Did anybody get it? Did anybody up? Verse 34. Howbeit, certain men clave. They held on tight. They rolled right with him. They were part of his posse entourage, for lack of a better term. They became part of his group. Certain men clave unto Paul and believed. Hello, somebody got the message. Did it get all of them? Mm-mm. But somebody believed. Paul allowed the stirring in his spirit to drive him to action. And look at that. Because of it, somebody came to accept Christ Jesus. Guess what? Now Paul has some help. Hello, somebody? Because Paul's not front of him. Remember, he's a visitor. This is their home field. But now when he leaves Greece, there's somebody standing around that ain't going to be standing at them altars and going up to this of the unknown God and all the mothers. Somebody going to say, man, why you don't? You used to go down to them altars every day and pray to Zeus. And why you don't do that no more? Man, you didn't hear Paul teach Jesus what? Let me tell you about it. He's leaving something behind. The work can go on. So it says here, some believe. It says, among them whom was also Dionysus Areopagite and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. As Paul shared, he made known to them this quote-unquote unknown God, so much so that somebody believed him. But look at what he was able to do. Number one, he was stirred to action. As he looked at the situation around him, Paul said and saw that these people said were wholly given to idolatry. Just whatever, just I want to worship this, I want to worship that, much like our brother here in India was talking about. They got Hindus there, Jainists there, Buddhism, Sikhism, Jainism, you know, all this other kind of stuff they do. He grew up worshiping stars, all this other kind of stuff. You look around and see, wow, somebody years ago realized those folks need to hear about Christ. That's why you have the Bible in their language now, such as a program like Through the Bible. But guess what? There are folks in your neighborhood that don't understand the language maybe that I'm speaking. You may have to break it down on terms they understand on your avenue or on your block. Amen? You may have to break it down and let them understand what Jesus is and what he means to you and how real God is. And guess what? That the time is out. Now, God winked. He kind of looked, you know, kind of winked a little bit at that foolishness. He said, the time now is for repentance. It's time to get it right. It's time to make myself known unto you. Because what did Romans tell us? The invisible things. Right? Remember what we looked at in Romans chapter 1? Even though it's invisible, God said it's still here. It's still real. There is still opportunity for folks to see and to accept. Even to see those things that are what? Invisible. The invisible things of God, we can know. Because you and I have faith. And I can't have faith for you, but I can invite you to have faith. Just give God a little bit. Because the Bible tells us every man is dealt a measure of faith. Guess what? Whether I put my faith in God or my faith in something else. But guess what? These people around here are putting their faith into these other little idols and things. These people in Greece, they were putting their faith into other things and what they could make and statues they could. So they had faith. They were just putting it in the wrong area. Putting their faith in the wrong thing. What you and I want to do is make sure that we put our faith in Christ Jesus. And remember what we said? That those things we have given him, he will keep against that day. God is going to do that. He's going to reward our faith on this morning. Okay? So the unknown God with that, as we get ready to go. A new commandment God has given to you and I. Right? That we love one another. Right? John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35 says, will somebody read it, please? A new commandment what?
A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I've loved you. That ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, and if ye have love one to another.